So, I'm standing up this time because I need to move around a lot with my camera for this video. So, I hope you guys like me standing up. I had a lot of comments about the connections of my studio. Not the social connections or the business connections. No, the electronic connections of my studio. How did I connect everything together in a way that actually works? I want to show this today to you guys, and I want to show two aspects of this. The first one is how I power everything, and the second one is how the audio runs through the studio. I hope you guys enjoy it and learn something along the way. Alright, so it's a bit narrow over here, but first things first, all rooms in this whole building, not only my studio, but the whole building over here, all rooms are equipped with at least two separated power outlets. One that is labeled audio, and another one, which is over here, that has got a number on it and is just a normal group. I call this outlet the vacuuming outlet, because this is where you plug in your vacuum cleaner. And this outlet is actually a special one. This outlet is actually connected, all the outlets in the studio are connected to a transformer, which actually gives us 120 volt and 120 volts on both pins. They are out of phase from each other, and in between we have 220 volts. I'm in Europe, I need 220 volts over here. The transformer also gives us exactly 220 volts, not 245 or something. We are in an industrial area over here, and the voltage is always a bit higher on an industrial area. So this makes sure that also our vintage equipment really likes this, and it's also noise free. So another thing that is happening with these outlets is that the fuses, we have automatic fuses on it, of course, and the fuses are super slow. Normally in a normal domestic home or domestic installation, you will have 8 character fuses. By the way, I'm not trained in this material, so I'm just trying to tell it in a way that you guys will understand it. A normal fuse cuts off almost immediately after you draw much more current. That type of fuse is called an A character. The fuses we use have got a C character, and we need to use a C character fuse because a lot of audio equipment, for instance the power supplies of my consoles, but also the power supplies, converters, preamps and that kind of stuff, they have huge capacitors in them. And when equipment is turned off for a little while, the capacitors are fully empty. And as soon as we switch them on, the capacitors get a lot of inrush current to fill themselves up. They want to be filled up as quickly as they can. And that inrush current immediately cuts out an A character fuse. So we have a C character fuse installed, but don't do this at your own home, because you need to have your whole installation checked if it's still safe to do that. So we of course had our installation checked and tested to see if we could handle a C character fuse, and luckily we could. So for these power things, I'm not telling more than this, because it's very dangerous stuff if you don't know what you're doing. And to be honest, I have studied electronics, but not power electronics like this. But it's a nice thing to know. So turning on the studio every morning is actually pretty simple. I don't do a stepped turning on or stuff. I just turn everything on at once, because it's possible and also because it's convenient. And for that I'm using a 19-inch rack mount power strip with a switch, which is over here, which I'm not going to press because everything will turn off by then. I do have multiple of these around the studio, so that I can turn on and off certain things in the studio if I want to, but normally everything's turned on and this is my main switch. Pretty easy. All right, so I made this a bit neat, but if I draw this thing up, what you can see over here, actually this shiny silvery thing is the power supply of the Neumann console. I do have 2 of these 19-inch rack mount power supplies. They are actually switch mode power supplies, not linear power supplies. Linear power supply is better for audio, but they draw so much more power that it's almost impossible to pay for running such a console. I'm using a switch mode power supply, but I do use one of the best there is. And this one is so stable that it doesn't induce any noise into the audio, if you combine it with good equipment, of course. 24 volts, and that all comes to the console over a 5-pin XLR connector. Well, not one,
every single unit has one. So
the other power supply lays over there in the back. There you can see it. That's the other power supply, is also 24 volts, and that is powering this console, but that one is still isn't ready, and I don't even know if it will ever become ready, but we'll see. All right, so let's move on to the audio part. So the main workhorse for all the digital audio stands over here. This is where all the audio comes from and goes to. This is my Mac Pro. I made a separate video about my Mac Pro, and I will link that in the corner if I don't forget it. So let's move over to the back for a bit. All right, so I don't have a lot of light down here, and it's also a bit a difficult position for me because I'm laying on the floor. But the most important thing is, well, this slot and this yellow network cable. This is my AVB cable, and this is also my AVB port on my Mac. Want to learn more about AVB? Then I will also link something in the corners if I don't forget it. What AVB can do is it can run 64 channels down one of these cables when running at 192 kHz, which I'm actually doing. So let's see what's on the other side of this cable. All right, so here you can see the other side of the yellow cable. It's over here. It's plugged in into the back of this thing over here. This is a Motu 16A, and this is my main interface, which I use to interface with all my analog equipment. But the front isn't really interesting, it's just a blue screen. I never look at it, that's also why it's tucked away in my rack over here, because it's not very interesting. Let's look at the back of this thing. All right, and at the back of the Motu, we'll see that the yellow cable comes in here, the Ethernet cable, and of course our power cable at the right. Not very special. What is very special are the jacks on the back side. So we have our inputs and our outputs over here. As you can see, I'm not using all the channels of the Motu. They are all reserved for future gear, so that I'm future proof. When I buy something, I can simply plug it in. Everything runs through the Motu with balanced jack cables, line level jack cables. If you ever buy a jack cable, make sure to buy a balanced one. You can recognize it by it having two black rings. If it only has one black ring, you're having an unbalanced cable, and that's not the best solution. All right, so we have our outputs and our inputs. Let's see where they go to. So actually they don't travel that far. They only travel to this bottom patch panel. I do have my outputs and my inputs over here so that I can also, you know, plug something in between my inputs or my direct outputs. I have to say, I almost never use it. These cables are almost rusted in place here. There's also a bit of dust on here, for I can see. So they're going from here to here, and on the back here is a multi-cable attached to it, a blue Van Damme multi-cable that actually runs to the back of the console. So let's take a look over there. When I designed my studio, I didn't actually thought about having two tripods over here, one for the light, one for the camera. But what we can see over here is, so the audio coming from the Motu is going into a channel over here. In this case, this is channel 9, and it comes here just by an XLR cable and goes into the line input of the console. I don't have preamps in the console, so I only have the line inputs over here. That's also the only thing that is actually connected to the line modules apart from the power supply, which is this cable. It's a thicker one, and it also has, I don't know if you can see it, but it has 5 pins, so that you cannot, you know, put it in the wrong hole. That would be very awful. What's more behind here? Well, the returns, of course. So our outputs are over here, which travel directly back to the Motu. Our female XLRs, and they are just coming out of the subgroups, master outputs, and that kind of stuff. There's also a multi-cable connector over here. It's partly out of frame. It looks like this, and this goes to a separate patch panel underneath the console for my own designed monitor controller, because I didn't have enough outputs at the back of the console to do this. So there's a separated cable for that over here. 16 channels it is, by the way. The last thing, the special thing, are these things. These are called tiny Bantam or tiny tail connectors. These are actually for the insert. So the console has got its own insert points. I like to use the pre-fader insert points, and the insert points are actually connected again to my patch panel on a different panel, which I will now show you guys. All right, So this is the panel I was talking about. It's a 3 units high panel. And over here we have our subgroups in and out. So this is for subgroup 4. We have our output over here and our input back over here. So if you want to patch the compressor in between here, we pick our output, we go with this cable to a compressor, for instance this one, into the input of the compressor. We pick another cable and get it from here back into the subgroup. Trained eyes will see that these don't have any connectors, and that's just because I'm lazy and I still need to make them. But I don't have that much outboard gear that I actually use that many inserts, so it's a low priority job actually. I didn't build this in the beginning because in the beginning my console only had 4 mono subgroups and not 8, because this part wasn't ready back then. That's how long it was ago that I made this panel. On top of this console interfacing panel, we have our analog outboard gear inserts. This panel is connected to a Blue Multi. You cannot see it, sorry. To Blue Multi, which actually goes to my rack in the back, which has all the outboard connected to it. And yeah, that's actually it. And now we're back again here, and that's actually all that I could tell and wanted to tell today to you guys. So there is one option that I have, and that is that I can also show you the infrastructure of Sound Vision Studio. That infrastructure is way bigger, way more complex. We have several recording rooms, we have headphone mixers, we have a lot of stuff going on. 96 channels in and out from Pro Tools. I could do a video about that. I need to discuss this with George first, but I first want to know before I start discussing this if you guys actually want to see that. So please let me know that in the comments below, and if I get enough comments, like a lot of comments, I will do that. It will take me a lot of time to do such things, so that's why I'm first asking that. That being said, thanks a lot for watching this video. If you want to support me, you can do that by clicking over here, and you will go to my Patreon campaign where you can sponsor me and stuff. Also, consider subscribing if you haven't already done that. Thanks a lot for watching this video, and I'll see you guys again in the next one. Bye bye.